ladies and gentlemen, and boys and girls of all ages. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. For those of you who don't know, my name is Jamie. I have Brian on camera with me this morning. I'm waiting until it gets a little bit lighter and there's a bit more ambient light and less clouds. There'll be Steph out and about on his on-foot wanderings along with Liam on camera. We also have Jerry and Kirst, who are in FC, and Eugene working on all of the technical side of things. That is involved in getting a live safari to you. And we're coming to you live from Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And we're also interactive, so please feel free to send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. At the moment, it's a nice cool start to the morning. As you can see, the cloud cover hasn't yet dispersed. I said yesterday I thought we were at the end of our frontal system and that the sun was going to be out today. Guess I was wrong, at least for the start of the morning. There is at this point a really noticeable difference in the morning light that we're experiencing. This temperature is sitting at around 20 degrees centigrade, which puts it at 86 degrees Fahrenheit. Nice nippy start. As our regular viewers know, we actually really enjoy these nice cool mornings. It gives us just a little bit of a break from what has been a scorchingly hot summer. I'm on my way to check, well, actually I'm debating a couple of options, but I think I've just decided where I'm on my way to. I think I'm on my way to the Buffleshoek boundary. I want to see if maybe, just maybe, we get lucky and the Nkuhumas have decided to come south. I haven't heard any lion calls this morning. Well, I have, but much further south than where we are at the moment. Also set out with a distinctly, let's say dodgy tire on my back right. So if at some point I have to jump out and change it, it's because my quick fix didn't work that well, but it should be okay. It's looking fine. We'll see. Should be okay. Of most of us, and our regular viewers included. Lucy, who's watching in Indiana, you said that you heard a hyena calling quite far from the Juma Dam pan at about 4:45 this morning. I also heard them when we were sitting in camp. So they are around. I haven't headed to the hyena den just because where we left things last night was quite a nice conclusion to the skirmish that was had, but in the back of my mind as well, I wanted to check Buffleshoek boundary just because, first of all, the hyenas like this road or this route that I've taken up in that direction, particularly because it seems to collect nice pans, nice muddy wallows. And after the last rains that we had, the hyenas spent a fair amount of time here wallowing in the mud. And that injured female from the fight yesterday morning also went off in the direction of the Buffleshoek boundary. I'm keeping an eye out for her as well. And for those of you who missed that particular incident, it was quite a very dramatic fight between two females attacking a third. All part of the clan, as far as we can tell, and I think we're definitely right about this. It was an internal skirmish, whatever. I don't know what she did to provoke it, but she was attacked by the female that we now believe to be the matriarch, which is Bella's mother, and as well as Pretty, so the hyena that's got November that covered the den. She then returned to the scene of the crime with Corky, which was also a slightly confusing moment for me because I assumed then that Corky had been caught up in the fight. Brian and myself both agree, it's definitely one of the most intense sightings of our lives, particularly when she tried to climb under the car to try and save herself. And one always feels, as a human being reacting to the animal's actions, one always feels a little bit heartbroken for the animal concerned. But we have no idea what their motivations were for it. These things happen out in the wild. They're probably more common than we realize. And it might have been something that was established or carried out for the good of the clan itself. There's one more mystery that remains to be solved. I'm still trying to figure it out myself, and that is when James first found that den site on Mvubu Road. If you cast your mind back to about 10 days ago or so, he had a female calling at the entrance to the den. And about 5 days later, when I was sitting at the old Gallego shortcut den, there was a female that also was wandering around the entrance. She was not quirky and not pretty. She was interacting with November on quite a almost maternal level, but she's not her mother. And it led us to believe that she had cubs as well. We still have yet to see them. Now, I don't know whether that means she's taken to another den site, which is a possibility. I might even pop into Gallego Shortcut Den on my way around here and just double check and see if maybe she has decided to have her or move her cub to the Gallego Shortcut Den. Or the fact that she's been calling so frequently and that we haven't seen the cub might, and I'm just throwing this out there as a possibility, I don't think we'll ever know the answer if it is the case, but it might be because she lost her cubs. It's a mystery that remains to be seen, and I think unless we see her with the cubs, we will never know the answer as to what happened. Millipede, off to drive over you. Dynamic and what we've learned has been a fascinating experience. Just, she was behaving like a mom, calling at den sites, interacting with the other cubs. And James, when I spoke to him before he went on leave, was absolutely convinced that there was a new set of cubs somewhere. Morning, Impala. This one over here, she's still pregnant. She's going to be one of the late births. I'm almost certain of it. So with Impala, most of you know by now that they've all pretty much had their babies, but if a ewe's mating isn't successful in the rutting season, so around the end of May, they actually go into a second rut around the end of June, which we saw the behavior of the Impala when I first started working here. Sort of the end of June, middle of July. And that gives rise to a couple of late births around February. And I'm fairly certain that actually both of these ewes get pregnant to me. Haven't quite got their svelte figures back. Interesting. So we're going to have a couple of late births. Might even find, because last year was a particularly dry wet season, not as bad as this year, but it was still fairly dry. Might even find an increase in late births. They're very nervous. They're quite on alert. I wonder what they're hearing. Wouldn't be surprised if the hyenas have been wandering around here all night. Could also be that they're reacting to other antelope moving in the bushes that they can hear, but they haven't quite determined what it is yet. It's just the way they've both gone stock still and how skittish they were when we first stopped to look at them. Up, girls. What do you see?
better?
I've relaxed a little bit. Still a bit jumpy. But also quite possibly a bit more jumpy because they feel pregnant and vulnerable. All right, girls. Come up. Update for those of you who might have missed the last few drives and are wondering why I'm driving on Bufalsuk Boundary looking for the Nkuhumas. The Nkuhumas as well as the Talamati Pride have both been sitting on Bufalsuk over the last few, I would say essentially over the last 2 weeks. The Nkuhumas keep moving backwards and forwards into Kruger and then back again. But I'm hoping because the Birmingham boys have been largely absent from this northern section. They've spent most of their time around Torchwood and south of that boundary. I'm hoping they might decide that today's the day to come wandering through. The reason that they've been so static in one particular position is because the drought has meant that the buffalo are forced to a couple of the big dams around Biffle's Hook. And essentially, they haven't needed to move. For about 2 weeks, they've just been moving backwards and forwards, catching a buffalo roughly every 3 days. And they've been enjoying their time spent there. What I would be interested in knowing, so the Nkuhumas have always had Juma as part of their core territory, but they've also very often moved up into Bufalsuk, and sometimes all the way towards Manuleti. And I would be interested to know how they interact with the Salati males. I've actually honestly got no idea. Because to the best of my knowledge, they've never been mating with the Salati males. They haven't really looked to them as the pride males, but I could be completely wrong about that because a lot of new research is starting to show that although you've got the dominant pride males, or at least the dominant territorial males that the pride members mate with and sometimes relax and share their kills with. But there's a lot of research that's starting to suggest that they will go and mate with external males or males not part or typically associated with that pride. And the statistic goes up to about 50% of cubs' fathers actually being a different male to the one that you would expect. So maybe they do interact quite peacefully with these Salati males. Since we're here at the Gallego shortcut, let's just go check that den site. See if maybe there's that female there. Liam, you'd like to know if hyenas are primarily nocturnal, diurnal, or a combination of both. And Liam, the answer to that is primarily nocturnal. They do most of their wandering, scavenging, and hunting. And they do hunt, and they hunt fairly successfully when they choose to. Most of that is done at night. And then what we've been doing recently is spending quite a bit of time at the den sites around this reserve. We've been incredibly fortunate that we've been able to spend as much time as we have. So it's usually around the early morning and the late evening that the mothers of the very young cubs tend to congregate around the den, and the rest of the members of the clan often pay a visit to the den site. It's sort of, although hyenas quite often in clans move off on their own, spend their days and their evenings wandering around solitary, the den site almost acts like a sort of a family home that everybody returns to come and say hello, reaffirm their clan bonds and stuff like that. It's a good place to observe the comings and goings. Now the den site I'm on my way to at the moment is one that was active a couple of days ago, but the cubs have just been moved. But I do want to just check and see if there's any action happening there. And Liam, I've said they're primarily nocturnal. That really doesn't mean that you won't see a hyena wandering around in the middle of the day. Generally, they spend the sort of the hottest period of the day sleeping in drainage lines around bushes. And if there's been rain and if there's puddles in the road or on the side of the road, then they'll go and they'll sleep in there. They do enjoy a good mud wallow. But I would say one of the few animal species out here that is, that this drought is working in their favor. Into the bushes. I wonder what went on last night. It would have been absolutely pitch black with this cloud cover. There would have been no ambient light. And there was a bit of a breeze last night as well. And I think that's put almost all of the prey species on edge. And what we've started suspecting on Juma is that the hyenas are actually hunting. It's supposition. But we did hear zebra alarm calling, and zebra generally don't alarm call for anything except lion or a fight amongst each other or possibly being hunted by a hyena. And I have seen hyena quite a few times hunt both zebra and kudu, so they're capable of taking down large prey. I'm going to need to come back and take a panga to this. Branches like that is people create new roads around them. And Sarah, who is watching in Ohio, Sarah, you're wondering if that injured hyena will be isolated from the clan now, or if she will still be part of it. Sarah, she'll still be, as far as I can tell, in my experience, she will still be part of the clan. She probably will go off and lick her wounds for a while. She was, you know, she was sore. She was not mortally injured. She'll be fine. But her leg was hurting her. Her ears were quite badly bitten. So I think she's going to wander off and lick her wounds for a while. But I think she'll still be a part of the clan, probably just still a subordinate part of the clan. Right, well, the sun has poked its head up over the horizon and Steph is out and about and would like to say good morning to you.
Well, good morning. We're standing here on Quarantine's open area, quite close to the camp. And the reason why we're standing here this morning is to try and do some tests on the backpack. Obviously, the last time we did a walk was a morning or two ago in the rain, and we couldn't get it right. There was some little gremlin that's crept into the pack, and unfortunately, I must say that gremlin doesn't seem like it's sorted out. So we are going to say good morning, and we're going to carry on walking around Quarantine and probably head straight back to the DRC and go and pick up Rusty. And take Rusty out so that we can carry on the drive and help you find something exciting. For those of you who are just joining this this particular show, my name is Stefan and I've got VM on camera. There we go. And we are on a bushwalk, a live bushwalk. First time in the world that this has ever been done. And even though we've been at this for quite some time, the amount of technical skill that goes into getting you a live bushwalk all the way from here to where you are at the moment is something quite astounding. And from time to time, these little things go wrong. So we're going to be heading off, going across this open area. This used to be a quarantine camp, believe it or not. It's where it got its name. And I don't quite know what they used to quarantine here. I have a feeling that it was wildebeest. A couple of years ago, the Sabi Sand used to swap white rhino. Can you believe it or not? There were too many rhino here. They used to swap white rhino for wildebeest, hundreds at a time. And I've got a feeling that this was the quarantine camp for those wildebeest. And incidentally, where Wiem the wildebeest got his nickname from is that the wildebeest keep on coming back here. It's an area that is renowned for good wildebeest, probably the best in the Sabi Sands at the moment. And for the reason, I think, is nice and open, and there's some good water close by. You've got Juma Dam and the Pan close by, and it's not right close, it's not right on. I'm always intrigued as to why some open areas work and why some open areas don't work, and this just seems to be one of those open areas that works for no reason that I can fathom, except for the fact that it's on a crest as opposed to below the crest. Also, it doesn't have water right in it. It has water probably about 500 or 600 meters away, 500 or 600 yards away. I think that those combined conditions make this quite a nice open area. It's a very lovely open area. Lion here, leopard here, cheetah here, wild dog here, wildebeest here, which are quite rare. Lots of elephant crossing over and doing their thing. And is one of the best places to see baboon spiders, or as they are known throughout the rest of the world, tarantulas, with some of them bigger than my hand, as you can see, probably nearly as big as my face if you had to put it on. We'll see if, as we walk along here, I can show you one of their burrows. They dig nice soft, well, they dig in nice soft substrate. The reason for that is because the females are so large that they'd attract some attention. So they ambush prey from a hole. They do not walk around. They dig holes from when they are very young. And at a point when they become mature, they lose the ability to be able to dig holes. And so what happens is that they dig a final hole, and that is where they will live for 20 years, 15 to 20 years. They can live up to 30 years old. Can you believe a spider as big as my face living for 30 years? That is exactly what happens. Let's take you up onto this termite mound here. For those of you who are long-term viewers of the show, we have a fireside chat from time to time on a Sunday and when we do TV shows. And this is the fireside chat venue. Right where we are now. This is the log that the presenters sit on, or the logs that the presenters sit on. As you can see, for a set, it's pretty basic. I wouldn't go. For a set, it's pretty basic. It just really consists of a fireplace with a few stones and a box carrying all of our fiber optic cables and everything. And it's nice and elevated. And I see at least our rain cover on our fiber optic case hasn't been eaten by hyena. The previous one that we had was absolutely eaten by hyena. I'm busy walking through here, busy looking for one of these baboon spider holes that I've promised you that I'd show you. And of course, because I've predicted that I'm going to try and show you a baboon spider hole, every baboon spider that is on quarantine will have camouflaged the entrance of their burrow. Now, females will give birth to babies, or eggs actually, which turn very quickly into babies, and then actually look after the young spiderlings up to their first or second instar. So they're actually quite big. They're about that big when they start to leave the nest. And they quite often, this time of the year, you'll see them standing at the entrance of the burrows, catching anything that comes past. As mentioned, they're old world spiders. And that means that they are ambush specialists rather than the more advanced spiders or the silk spinning spiders. Every spider produces silk. It's one of the characteristics of a spider. But some spiders can use different types of silk and in many different kinds of ways. The orb spiders are probably the most advanced of the spiders, or evolved of the spiders, as they say. And that is evident in the way that they build their webs, a very intricate entanglement and then sticking to the web and then all the different kinds of silk that they produce along the way. Whereas these baboon spiders literally just rely on sheer size and strength rather than clever ways of catching big things. Oh, Matthew from LA, Los Angeles, has asked me, are there any pine trees in South Africa? Having a look at these huge trees that you can see around us. And what type of wood do we use for furniture making? Matthew, we don't have any pine, well, there are pine trees in South Africa, huge forests of pine trees, but they've all been planted. They are not endemic to South Africa. However, we do have one species of cypress, the mountain cypress. It's the only type of tree like that that we have in, that's endemic to South Africa. Other than that, there are very, very many hardwoods that are used in South African furniture making, with I suppose the most significant one being the yellow wood. I think it's Pterocarpus. Is the genus, but anyway, the yellowwood, the Otanequa yellowwood, and the real yellowwood. South Africa's one of South Africa's trees. It's as far as I understand the national tree of South Africa. The yellowwood was used extensively in furniture making and in home building before it became a protected species, of course. But it is probably the most famous, and there are many. I would dare say there are maybe as many as about 100 different species of trees, maybe even more. Not a carpenter, I'm sure that'll answer, but I've just noticed there's some elephant off to our left-hand side. Now, on foot, elephant are the most dangerous animal that we can approach, especially a breeding herd. Female elephants are notoriously intolerant of people on foot around them and their calves. So it becomes very, very important when you are going to get closer to elephant and elephant herds that you take whatever cover you can, whatever concealment you can, and most especially you take the wind into consideration. So I have the wind blowing slightly into my face, which is a good thing. And what we're going to do is try and use the cover of these termite mounds to get you a little bit closer so that we can show you these elephants on foot. It's always exciting to be on foot with big, large, dangerous, scary animals. And the reason for that is that they make you feel so small and insignificant. Now, we've got these elephants moving slowly towards us. And I'm almost convinced that at some point, these elephants are going to be coming after these fruit. This is a green marula. Elephant go absolutely crazy for marulas. This is a marula tree. It's jam-packed with fruit. And these elephants are even right now standing underneath the marula tree, busy picking up these fruits. And they go to extraordinary lengths of going after these fruit. We're not exactly sure why. The fruit obviously quite high in sugar. They're not giving the elephant any, they're not making the elephant fat. I think it's just because they taste nice, to be quite honest. And elephants will go out of their way to come after this fruit. Now what I'm going to do is change my tactic just a little bit. As you can see, we got to this termite mound, and now I see that the termite mound that I was aiming at is actually a little bit too close to those elephants, and the wind is moving downslope. So whereas before the wind was coming into my face, as soon as we crested this hill, I feel that the wind has now changed slightly. What I don't want is I don't want the scent of Vieminar's perfume this morning mixed with coffee, mixed with rusk, mixed with camphor cream. Definitely not any shaving cream this morning for either Viem or I. I don't want the smell of that wafting onto these elephants. Not that they're gonna immediately just run over here and throw Viem and I into the top of the tallest tree, but we don't want to let those elephants know we're here. In actual fact, the aim of one of these walks is to be so unobtrusive through the bush that the elephant don't even realize that we're there, and we can view them undisturbed and unfettered, part of the whole experience of a walk. So I'm going to change slightly the heading. We're going to head to this clump of bushes here. From those bushes, we're going to try and head to that termite mound and see what it looks like when we get there. So come along. Now, there's no reason for you to be alarmed at what we're doing at the moment, even though it's fairly open here where we are, and visibility, or I got lots of visibility, but there's not lots of places that Viem and I can hide. There's no reason to believe that we're going to be posing any significant threat to these animals, and we're going to try and be as careful as we can. So now I'm at these bushes. And what we're going to do is now, we are definitely close enough for our silhouette to be skylined, because we are higher than these elephants. If I had to all of a sudden walk out into open here, I'm changing the skyline, and my man shape could definitely upset these elephants. So what we're going to do is just stick our heads slowly off to the side of this bush so that we can get to see what these elephants are up to. And they are slowly feeding underneath these marula trees. They're moving down the valley, going from bush to bush. Now, it's because it's so dry at the moment, I can fully expect that these elephants are feeding in and around the 20 to 22 hours per day. So let's say 18 to 22 hours per day, to get enough food in them to keep them healthy, which is a long time. Here we've got another elephant coming off to our left hand side, and just shows you that keeping good situational awareness is key to being on foot out here in the bush. You don't want to get so absorbed in what you're watching, you don't notice something coming sneaking up on you from behind or from an area that you're not keeping your eyes open for. To me, that looks like another female. And there's a female in there with beautiful tusks. She's really got some lovely, gorgeous ivory on her, as they say. So right now, these elephants are completely unaware of where we are. We're not going to get any closer. As you can see, there is no real cover between us and the elephant at all. There's one scraggly little tree and a termite mound, but the wind is blowing directly towards them from that area, and that'll offer us little or no protection at all. So this is it. This is as close as what we're going to get to these elephants. As mentioned, the aim of these bushwalks is not to stand here and show you how scary I can be and scare away these animals. It's so that we can be part of the environment, we can be part of the bush. And I think the biggest trick that I learned while I've been operating on foot is when to call it, when to actually say, this is close enough, let's get a bit closer. And make no mistake, I've been close enough to touch elephant many times, but this situation is not one of those situations. We don't know how these elephants are going to react. We've got this elephant, she's now slowly making her way along the same line of travel as her family group. And what is going to happen at some point is she's going to walk into our scent. The wind is now gusting from behind us. And she will absolutely get a trunk full of our scent. What will be interesting for you to note is at which point she does. I'm quite happy with where we are right now. Even though we haven't got any elevated position really close by to us. I see there's even another elephant off to the left hand side. So we are surrounded by elephant. Because we're not dealing with one single female anymore, I am going to move us slightly crosswind so that our scent doesn't blow onto these elephants. I think, come here, before they get onto the open area, we're going to use the cover we have of the trees here. So using these trees, these ones here, we're going to use this termite mound, and we're going to use those trees there. Ah, and the inevitable question from Brian is, firstly, good morning, Brian. So, if the elephants are eating for up to 20 hours a day, when do they get to sleep? Well, the easy answer, Brian, is when you're very hungry and you need to eat as much as what these elephants are eating, sleep becomes secondary. That is the easy answer. The more complex answer is that most animals out here in Africa have developed the ability to function on very little sleep. Animals such as giraffe, for instance, only really need about 20 minutes a day. All right, so now we've made our way onto the crest. We've used distance and we used the cover around us to try and mask our approach. It's amazing. The wind is swirling around the top of this tree, and where just now our scent was blowing straight in the direction of these elephants, right now the wind is gusting towards the top of this hill. We're going to get here behind this tree. Excuse the expression that I've got on my face, the pinched expression I have on my face. I am battling to hear Jerry in final control. She's coming through as a hiss in my ear. So I'm sure she's asking me a question from one of you, but unfortunately I can't hear a thing. So I'm just going to carry on telling you about some elephants, and hopefully the radio signal gets a little bit better. So now what we've done is we've used this avenue of trees, and we've approached through this avenue of trees, which has allowed us some concealment. You can see exactly what I mean by the avenue of trees here. We are now once again upwind of these elephants, which means that the wind is blowing from us into a direction that's not towards the elephant, which makes it a lot safer for VM and I. The area where we're at the moment may seem like it's quite safe. We're right close to camp. We've got lots of trees around, but in actual fact, we are very limited to our choice of where we've got to go. With elephants, if you do happen to pick a fight with an elephant, getting elevation is always the key. You want to try and get as high as you can, as quickly as you can. But in this particular case, we are using distance, and we are using whatever sparse tree cover we've got to shield our approach, and we're in complete safety right now. As I mentioned, the trick here is to try and decide at which point you call getting close to elephant. And at this point, with only a few scraggly trees between us and the elephant, this is the point that I'm happy with. And to give you an idea of how close we are to these elephants, we are probably about 100 yards, 150 yards from these elephants. Completely and totally unaware of our presence. The reaction that we can expect from an elephant that knows we're there is a head up reaction. Quite often over the last few days and weeks, you've seen in particular a young elephant standing with their ears open and their heads held high, trying to posture at the vehicles. That is exactly the reaction that we don't want to see from these elephants. That is a reaction where of an elephant that's alerted and absolutely. Female elephants in the Sabi Sand, in particular with babies, will adopt that head up, trunk up, ears flared posture that we see in those young elephants with the cars. They will adopt that when they smell man smell on feet without cars. And I absolutely think that elephants are clever enough to distinguish between a man smell and a vehicle smell combined as one, and a man smell on foot. And alone. And of course, we as humans have been hunting these poor animals for their ivory from at least the time of the pharaohs in Egypt. So we're looking at 2,000 or 3,000 years of persecution. And man smell without the association of vehicles is a very scary thing for these elephants still. It's almost an ingrained fear. Are they moving off? Still oblivious to us, it's going to allow us to once again follow them a little bit. Now they are almost at exactly the spot where VM and I were standing but a few minutes ago. The bush that they are approaching at the moment, the bush that that elephant is approaching at the moment, is where VM and I were standing literally. About 5 minutes ago or so. Isn't that lovely? These elephants are going down to the water holes at the camp. I think that they haven't had a drink since yesterday. And they are making their way through to either the pan in front of Galago or the pan in front of Vuyatela. For your sakes and for the dam camera's sake, I hope it's the dam in front of Vuyatela. You can get to see them go and have a drink of water. All right. I still can't hear final control, and so what I'm going to do is sort of preempt a link to Jamie so that we can go and get our radio comms sorted out. I'm so glad that you got to see these elephants on foot with myself and VM. We'll be out again in probably 25 or 30 minutes once we've got Rusty up and running. See you in a little bit.
Like you guys had an amazing time with Steph and those elephants. So I've got an update for you, and it's a combination of fact and guesswork. I'll give you the facts. Brian and myself went to the Galago Shortcut Den, and the first thing that hit us overwhelmingly was the smell of decomposition. Something died there, or something is dead there. I got out, I walked all the way around the den to check and see if maybe it was, oh, leopard tracks. Sorry. I'll finish that story in a moment. Oh, leopard tracks. So, Deb, you heard a leopard calling last night. Here's his tracks. Whether it's Mbula or Tingana, I do not know. One of the two. Difficult at this point. Their boundary, their territorial boundary is fairly fluid. Let's see if I can show you them. Light's not ideal. There you go. Hold on, let me hop out. Oops, sorry, Brian. Let me hop out 1 second. Just show you what I mean. This one?
Yeah.
Cool. So, just looking at these tracks here, the bit that you can see, it might be a little bit tricky to kind of see which way, what's happening. There's one, two, three, four toes. There's the back pad here. For new viewers, the best way to tell the difference between cat tracks and dog and hyena tracks is the lobes at the back. So if we look at it really carefully, there's one, two, three lobes at the back. For dogs and hyenas, they only have two lobes at the back pad. It's also the shape. Leopard tracks are really nice and neat. How do I know it's a male? Well, the size. Okay, so this track is almost the size of my palm. If it was a female or something like that, it would be much, much smaller. His front track, which is the bigger round one, is over here. Yeah, it's sort of, that's roughly the size and shape. His back track, which is the smaller and more elongated one, makes almost like a teardrop. And the distance between the two of them, the fact that they don't meet, usually what leopards do when they walk is they register. So this back track, oopsie, he's messed up his beautiful track. His back track would usually fall on his front track. It's a way of walking soundlessly. But the fact that his back is stretched out in front of his front track tells me that this leopard was walking with a determined pace down the road. Let's see if we can find him. Tingana, Mvula, could be either. Tricky tracking in this light, but I'm sure we will give it our absolute best shot, and I would suspect he's wandered down somewhere towards that Muwati drainage line. Cool. Right, before I talk a bit more about tracking leopards, give me one moment to just call it in. Konzo for my daughter Ingwe, moving south down Bowery Cutline. We'll be following up. Just calling it in on the Game Drive channel so that the guys know and that possibly I can call for reinforcements to come and help me. Let's just finish up with our hyena story. So I walked all around the den. Sometimes spotted hyenas, particularly with sub-adult cubs, bring old parts of a kill back to the den. This didn't have that particular scent to it. Didn't smell like an old carcass. It smelled like a fairly fresh decomposition. And I stuck my head over all of the entrance burrows, and it was emanating from one burrow in particular. We'll never know for certain because I couldn't see anything in it. And you'll have to forgive me, but it's always a very bad idea to stick your hands into burrows. You never know who's lurking or what's happening down there. So I didn't stick my hand in to try and see what was down there, or indeed stick my head right in to try and see what was down there. But there was definitely a very, very strong stench of death coming from one particular hole. I'm 90 personally, but now it goes into the, that's the fact. I'm personally 90% certain that there is a dead cub down there, or two dead cubs maybe. So that female that we saw calling, I would say there's a very good chance that she lost her cubs at that den. How? We'll never know. Could well be because the older cubs killed it. Could also be because something happened. They might have died when they were born because we never saw them. We heard her calling and we saw her moving between the two dens, but we never really... All right, I'm just checking this tree. I always check this jackalberry. One day, I will stop to check this jackalberry tree and there'll be a leopard in it. Hasn't happened yet though. And I'm pretty sure I've checked it on almost every drive. One day it will happen. So, as to what happened, we can only guess. We know that hyena cubs do kill each other on occasion. It's about a 9 to 10% chance of that happening, or it's happened in studies done, it's happened in about 9 to 10% of the cases. We know that occasionally aunts do kill cubs as well. Maybe they got a little bit too curious with the other cubs. We'll never know. I suspect that's what happened. Whether or not it is connected to the fight we saw yesterday, my suspicion... Sorry, now I need to focus on two things at once. I need to see where these leopard tracks went. I think he probably went down here, but I'll double check. My suspicion, and I don't really know why I think this, is that it is connected. Yeah, I walked here. But I don't really know why I think that, and I don't really have a theory as to how it's connected. Unless she just, her instincts were so strong and she decided that maybe this was the best way to approach things, and by mothering the other cubs. Maybe the other females got frustrated with that. I honestly don't know. This is pure supposition on my part and we'll never know. But I think it's fairly safe to say, unless one of the older cubs dropped a piece of carcass into that burrow, again, I don't think is likely. I think that a female has lost her cubs, and I suspect it's that same female. There you go, that's my... That, I think, really is the end point of the story for now. I don't think we can go any further in terms of guessing exactly what happened. And I've just heard on the Game Drive channel that... They're all quite contented and peaceful at the hyena den itself. I'm going to focus now on looking for this leopard, because Deb reported she heard this leopard soy at about 1 o'clock this morning from the Juma Dam camera. Let's go investigate. Keep your eyes peeled. You never know where we might spot him. Doesn't mean that Karula is not around here. And Sleepy One, you were wondering when last we saw Karula. It was with James, I think, as far as I know. It was with James on the Galago shortcut around the firebreak. I'm just checking really carefully in this drainage line, because it would be a good place to have heard a leopard last night. Although on a cold morning like this morning, particularly if he's patrolling his territory, I think he's going to stick around, but keep your eyes peeled. Look for that flash of white of a tail while I chat to you and try and remember exactly when last we saw Karula. So Sleepy One, it was with James up near the fire break and she crossed north into Buckles Hook. That's not a leopard, that's a log. That must have been... When did James leave? Where are we? What day of the week is it? It's been about a week ago, roughly, that we last saw Karula. She crossed into Buckles Hook around Sydney's Dam. The guys reported her tracks, and they're usually quite good at identifying individuals' tracks. They reported her tracks around again around Sydney's dam a couple of days later. So she must have wandered into Simbambili and then gone back again. And that was the last time, I believe, that Karula was seen by any of us and any of the guides. But she'll be around. I'm sure she will suddenly appear out of nowhere. The wonderful thing about Karula is she doesn't say where she's come from or where she's going. She's marvelously unpredictable, or she is, at least to me. I find her quite mysterious in that respect. She doesn't seem to have any set pattern of movement, but then she's a leopard. That's what leopards do. And they wander far and wide, and Karula, of course, has the biggest territory of any leopard in the Sabi Sands, or at least in her prime she did. And probably this little dacre has a rough idea of where that leopard is. He would definitely be on the menu. You shy little one. At least you're being more cooperative than the dacres I've seen over the last few days. Little female. Look at the mohawk. She's kind of an impressive one. Shame girl. That was quite nice. They're quite shy little antelope. It's not often that we really get to spend all that much time looking at them. Tiny little territories. Probably from the dam until here would be roughly the size of that dacre's territory, where she will live with her mate, and they remain mates, they're monogamous-ish. Interesting thing about dacres, they're monogamous-ish. So they stay in the territory with their mate, males and females, and they're very defensive about, so females will guard the territory against other females, and males will guard against other males. And one of the reasons behind that approach is because quite often dacre are actually secretly unfaithful. So the female, and they forage separately, they don't spend their entire day together. So if a female dacre is wandering around foraging in her territory and an unknown male happens to pop in and she happens to be an estrus, she will mate with him, and vice versa for the males. But not all dacres do it, apparently. There's been some really interesting studies into the way that they interact. Some of them are completely, I suppose you could say, completely faithful and monogamous. Dated me and said that day that I was thinking of with James and Tebs was the 5th of January. So I again have lost track of time. I said it was a week ago, it was close to 10 days ago. Oh, almost right. Southern boo-boo calling. This Wahlberg's nest. As far as I know, Brian, have you seen any activity in it?
Lately, no.
No, I haven't either. I also haven't seen the parents around it recently. I haven't seen any movement in it. It's quite sad because I actually don't think it survived if they had an egg there. And I wonder whether it's not because this knobthorn actually doesn't have much in the way of leaf cover. It's been so hot that egg probably sat in the blazing sun at times. I mean, that's not the parents' fault. There's not much they can do if the drought has been so severe that the trees don't have their usual amount of foliage. And I mean, those Wahlbergs have been using that nest site year after year, but I think this year it just didn't work for them. I don't know what the success rate of nests is, but they actually tried to build another nest. Sorry, distracted in my leopard search, but they've actually tried to build another nest lower down after the first one. And I wonder whether that wasn't because the cover wasn't sufficient. And as far as I know, this nest site has been used successfully every year, And there you can see where they started constructing a second nest and then abandoned it. And come to think of it, I haven't seen them since I got back. And that realization's only really just hit home now. Okay. Right. If you were a male leopard, where would you go? Into the drainage line would be my guess. The difficulty here lies. I wish I could tell if it was Tingana or Nvula. Because it just makes it slightly easier to guess where they might go. This is roughly, the boundary of Nvula versus Tingana's territory. Tingana's been pushing hard into the eastern quarters of, or to into the east of his territory and into Nvula's territory. And apparently he was seen close to Torchwood, or coming out of Torchwood a couple of weeks ago. So he's really pushing quite hard into Nvula's territory. And Nvula is getting, apparently, I mean, I've only known Nvula for the last few months, but apparently is looking quite old. And there have been a couple of reports from the guides to say he's looking quite thin as well. But that could just be a stage he was going through. He might have had a couple of unsuccessful hunts. But if it was Nvula or Tingana, we could sort of guess whether we go left or right, east or west. Tracks disappeared down towards the drainage line. To continue our leopard update. So Tingana is the Don Juan of the leopard world, and over the last 3 months we've seen him mating repeatedly. There was actually a period where he moved from leopardess to leopardess in the space of a few days, mating with Gorilla, then with Shadow. And Justin, you were wondering whether or not there's any more news on the possibility of Shadow having cubs. There was an update from one of the guides that they had closed an area because they thought they heard cub noises and saw tracks and heard her calling. It was a little bit premature because no, she does not have cubs. There's no evidence that she has cubs, and in fact it would be a bit early because she was mating with Tingana. Oh boys. Oh yay, there's our two yellow balls. Sorry, I'm gonna move forward again. Is our one yellow bull. It's usually two. This is the second. Here you go, guys. For newish viewers, that is a yellow bull ox picker. Red bull on the left, yellow bull on the right, and actually that's a perfect opportunity to look at this size comparison. Ox pickers, man. They're just being uncooperative recently. So the yellow-billed oxpecker, the reason I'm quite excited about it is because it's actually quite a rare bird, much less common than the red-billed oxpecker. Luckily for us, both of them have disappeared from view. But yes, there was a time when the, oh hello, yellow-billeds were critically endangered. Thank you, oxpecker. So possibly a new one. For new viewers, bird lists. Our regular viewers have them ticked off, of course. And for new viewers, I would encourage you to keep a bird list. There's so many fascinating species that fill all kinds of ecological niches in this particular place, acting as a nostril cleaner for the buffalo. And obviously, not isolated to the nostrils. Well, also clear ticks away from ears, eyes, armpits, underneath the tail, wherever they happen to find them. Definitely a very helpful bird. If I reverse backwards, it's going to move, isn't it? Let's give it a go. Let me try. I don't know where the other one is. And I say the other one as though you can predict it that well. The only reason I'm saying that is a few times that we've seen the yellow-billed oxpeckers, there's always been two of them. Now there's just one. I wonder if it's not somewhere that I can't see it. buffalo looks as though he's actually quite enjoying the attentions of that ox pecker, getting rid of all of those ticks and itches. So the yellow-billed is quite an uncommon one, but the red-billed ox pecker that we saw earlier is actually very common. And Lane, you were wondering which bird species we see most commonly out here. Sure, hornbills, yellow-billed and red-billed are quite high up on the list. Red-billed ox pickers are high on the list. Cape turtle doves, emerald-spotted wood doves, and fork-tailed drongos. I would go with that's pretty much the top of the list in terms of the most common bird species. There are really common bird species that are around pretty much constantly, but because they're so small, we don't always get to see them. He's scratching his nose, I think. Or is he just sniffing? I think that was a scratch. Oopsie daisy. Getting laboriously up to his feet. Don't be fooled though. They might look slow and gentle, but these Duggar boys are pretty much the exact opposite of that. I think he... Oh, I thought he was going to go and have a scratch. But I think he's having a little bit of one. But he's more interested in the grasses at the base of that tree. Shame. Not much grass for them to eat. You can see it. You can really see the effect of the drought when you look at the grass layer. He's okay looking. Not too thin. But when you look at patches like this, you can see why the drought hits animals like buffalo hard. And I'm talking more in the next few months, because we're coming into our dry season in the next two or so months. Hello, boy. What's up? Observing us closely. That's... Didn't appreciate that ox pecker in his ear. There's a nice, there you go. Now you can see a bit of a size comparison and how much smaller the red-billed ox picker is than the yellow-billed. Actually, they've got a broader bill as well, the yellow-billeds. Hello, boy. Are you going to chew that grass or just look at us and keep it in your mouth? Oof. I always get the shivers when I see those ox pickers go around the eyes. Just the thought of having a beak anywhere near my eyes, not appealing. Double checking the inside of the ear cavity. All the sensitive spots that the ticks are most likely to latch onto. And you can actually see, if you watch that ox pecker closely, you can see how the tail feathers are stiffened as a way of helping to prop it up. And if we're really lucky, we might even be able to have a look at the way that the foot structure grips. Because they spend a lot of their time holding onto the sides of animals and on a very precarious perch. It's not like being able to wrap your claws around a branch. Can't be that easy to stay on. So they're very specially adapted to the way that they hop around on buffalo backs and giraffe backs. Cheers, boy. There's another buffalo off to our right. Just an update for regular viewers who see him. He's got a broken left horn, as far as I can tell. He moved the head ever so slightly, so that Brian's got a clearer view. But I definitely recognize him, and I'm sure regular viewers will as well. Got one broken left horn and a very bald face. obviously got some kind of skin disorder. You'll have to take my word for it that he's got a broken left horn. He doesn't want to turn and look at us. Not interested. Just finishing off our conversation on bird species that we have in the area. Brian, you wanted to know whether or not we get something known as a grackle. No, not to the best of my knowledge. And I don't think I've ever heard of it anywhere further north either. Ooh, nearly tripped there. A bit of a stumble. I'm double checking, Brian, in my bird book just because I want to make sure I'm not lying to you. No. Grackles are, there we go, hello boy, thank you. There you can see his broken left horn. Imagine the force of the impact that's needed to break something like that. Whoop, oopsie daisy. Itch. Brian, I actually don't know much about a grackle. I'm trying to think if we have any relatives of it, but I have to confess, I'm fairly unfamiliar with the grackle as a species. It's a bird that's more common around the North Americas. So if anyone has any suggestions as to whether or not we have a relative of the grackle that might live in here or live in the Sabi Sands, you can send that through. Possibility, apparently, that grackles are related to starlings and that they have a gloss and an iridescence to them. Quite a dark coloured bird, apparently. I'm really speaking completely out of the top of my head because I'm unfamiliar with the grackle species. What do you think, Buffalo? Not much. Just making sure he keeps a close eye on us. Amazing to watch the different personalities with these Duggar boys. There's always one who's slightly unimpressed with our presence and prefers to keep a close eye. And behind them, that buffalo without the horn is having a seriously thorough scratch of his face. Shame. And that bald patch of skin probably is incredibly itchy. And there's not much he can do about it except rub it on the foliage. Okay, thank you, Buffalo, for being cooperative and for showing us the yellow-billed oxpeckers. I think it's time for us to go and find a leopard now, before he manages to get too far away. I just wish I knew where he disappeared off to. Let's go check Spaghetti Junction in the Mulwati. That's a nice, clear, sandy patch to look for tracks. And of course, for those of you keen for an update. Sorry. I just drove through a patch of buffalo dung, fresh buffalo dung, and then put my face down to look for tracks. That was a rookie error. A seriously rookie error. Because the tires fling dung straight up at you. I was lucky I didn't get splattered there, which would have been probably more entertaining for everybody else. So yes, for those of you wondering for updates on Karula, at this point, she was mating with Tingana roughly 2 months ago, possibly even close to 2.5 months ago, but I think it was 2 months ago. So she could well be pregnant, but she was seen with Tingana a couple of days, about 2 weeks ago. No I'm uncertain as to whether or not she's pregnant. I don't want to say anything. I don't want to create any kind of supposition or theorizing. She either is or she isn't. We won't know just yet. It's too soon for us to say. Oh, and back to Shadow, just quickly. For new viewers, leopards have a gestation of roughly 3 months in time. So they'll have cubs 3 months after mating. So the fact that there was that Shadow was suspected to have cubs was a little bit premature, because she was actually seen mating with Tingana beforehand, about a month and a half before that. So unless she had the world's quickest leopard pregnancy, it was a little bit unlikely. As far as I know, and from what research I've done, leopards will not mate if they are already pregnant. But good news for those of you who missed it the other day, we had a really brief sighting with Putile. Last time we'd seen her, she was mating with Tingana, and she'd actually just lost a litter of cubs. It was a mystery as to how it happened. But apparently, the Arethusa guides are saying that she's got three new cubs denning somewhere around Hofmans, which is such exciting news. Hey, look, I found my pregnant kudu without even trying. Hello. No, big girl. Regular viewers know I've been keeping track of this particular group of kudu, because it contains three bulging females. We've spoken about attempting to get a live kudu birth on one of these shows. We've been following up with them pretty much every day. Yep, still pregnant, still there, still pregnant. I can only see one at the moment. I'm not sure where the rest of them are. It's not the one with the nice stripe. The nice, easy identifying stripe on her bottom. And if she's going to oblige us as she walks around, you can see how bulging she is. And walking with what I can only describe as a pregnancy waddle, the way that she's moving. Distinctly uncomfortable look. Oh well. That was entirely accidental. I wasn't really looking for them, but I guess we found them. Nice to have a little bit of an update on that kudu herd. Now, Steph is back up and running and out on Rusty, and he'd like to say hello again.
Well, we're back on the trusty steed, Rusty, although saying that gives me shivers down my spine, but we are back on Rusty nonetheless, and we have come to find that herd of elephant that we were with on foot a little bit earlier, and we have in some very, very thick bush. This was one of the elephant cows that we were having a look at. Very tough for me to say at the distance that we were at which of the females this is, but nevertheless, she's an enormous female, and she's got the most bizarre tusks. Definitely not the weirdest tusks we've seen here at Yuma. We have got those few elephant cows that have those one forward-facing and one backward-facing tusk. She's got tusks that pinch together in front of her eyes and almost are touching one another. I'm hoping that she allows us to see. You can see there we go. You can see those two tusk points. Quite bizarre for a female elephant to have such upward curving tusks. Usually their tusks follow the line of their trunk. For this elephant to have these upward curving tusks is what make her so special. Her tusks are unique to her. They will grow throughout her life. And generally, female tusks tend to be a little bit more symmetrical and beautifully shaped. They're a lot more elegant than the male's bulky tusks that they use to fight with and for display purposes. ivory, of course, at a stage was a luxury commodity and used in almost everything from carvings through to billiard balls, buttons on shirts, through to you name the most bizarre things that people have made with ivory, traded in it, killed for it, and it has eventually led, or almost led, to the elephant's extinction. Has led to the elephant's extinction in some parts of Africa, and without human intervention back in the 80s, definitely would have resulted in the complete annihilation of the elephant populations in South Africa. In actual fact, I read a very interesting fact a couple of years back on the Kruger National Park. In 1903, there were no elephants in the present-day Kruger National Park, but footprints of an elephant were recorded in 1903. In 1905, three elephant bulls crossed the South African-Mozambique border and walked into the Kruger National Park. And here we are in 2016, and there are roughly 18,000 elephants in the Kruger National Park at the moment. How different times are. Elephants are really, really good at adaptation. They really bounce back from calamity really quickly. Very hardy, adaptable creatures. We've had, looking at tusks, I'm sure has generated this question from Lane, who's watching us on YouTube. Lane has asked, have I ever seen elephants fight with other animals, and if so, what animals they are? Lane, I absolutely have watched elephant fight with other animals. They do not tolerate the presence of other animals easily. Elephants are notoriously intolerant of other species around them. I've watched elephant fight buffalo, I've watched elephant fight rhinoceros, I've watched elephant fight lion, leopard, cheetah, wild dog, impala. Yes, that's probably what I've watched elephant fight. Obviously, most animals just get out of the way. Elephants are big, scary things. And most animals get out of the way. But a couple of years ago, and I'm talking probably around about 10 to 15 years ago, the elephants in the Sabi Sand went through a session of killing rhinoceros. And in 1 year, I can clearly remember three rhinoceros just on the piece of property that I was busy guarding on, die from being tusked to death by elephant. Although, you know, just talking to you now about it makes me want to say that there were probably a lot more than that that were tusked to death by elephant. There's, on YouTube, funnily enough, a couple of clips of elephant giving buffalo a hiding and doing some damage to buffalo. And then, of course, there's any number of videos which show elephant chasing around impala and all other species, including man. So there you go, that female, that big female was walking through the bush and then all of a sudden stopped and went completely motionless. That is because she was hearing something. That is a typical posture of a female elephant that was listening to some communication of some sort. Their hearing range is much, much better than ours. Not only can they hear softer noises, but they can also hear or are sensitive to a wider range of frequencies, from ultrasonic, or infrasonic, excuse me, not infrasonic, and not ultrasonic, infrasonic, ultra low wave pulses, all the way up to the most unbelievable scream that they can give. This small family group is now moving into some very thick bush. Leanne in Memphis talking about their senses. Good morning, Leanne.
Leon, you've asked, oh, is elephant eyesight very good? It's not bad. It's probably about as good as what ours is, Leon. They also see in color. However, their eyes are angled towards the ground, towards the end of their trunk. And you can literally walk in front of an elephant. If it doesn't have its head up, it won't really see you. They really need to peer down their nose at you. It's almost a myopic vision that they have, down towards the ground and the point of their trunk. For them to see any distance, they have to lift their head up quite high, which looks uncomfortable. It looks ungainly. It allows them to, you probably see about as far as what we can, you know, a couple of hundred feet, 100 yards. But generally, they're just looking at what their trunks are fiddling around with. Now, I'm quickly going to reposition the car so that we can get close to that female with the gorgeous tusks again. It might get a little bit bumpy as we move through here. I'm going to try and make it as painless as possible for all of you out there. I know that these branches and bushes that we scrape alongside the side of the car can sound absolutely terrifying to those of you who covet vehicles. But let me tell you, these cars have been doing this for the last 20 years or so. How they still run every day is beyond me. But nevertheless, they do. All right, now, this isn't, I know, VM, this isn't the best view that I've got for you. There is an elephant in that bush, I promise. She's one of the biggest female elephants that I've seen in a while, and she is almost completely hidden by one scraggly little buffalo thorn tree and a roos that she's feeding on at the moment. Brian, who is asking us some questions on Twitter, just asked me, what is the lowest hertz range that elephant can produce? Now, Brian, unfortunately, off the top of my head, I don't actually know the answer to that question, to be honest. But I am going to quickly delve into my reference books here. I have an entire case of books. And at a point, I actually had an article on infrasound and elephants. I did find it on the internet. It is available on the internet. And much like whales, elephants are big enough to produce this infrasound. And I'm going to see if perhaps one of my books here have it. Otherwise, what I will do is pitch it straight back at our viewers. No, it's not in this one book that I have that is full of the most bizarre facts on animals that you can get. It's not in that one. So what I will ask is for any one of us or any one of the viewers out there who have access to an information resource that isn't limited to the couple of books I have in my possession with me out here, to just find out what is the hertz range of an elephant for me, if you wouldn't mind. Share it with us on the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email the answer through to questions@wildearth.tv, and I'll share it with everybody. And that way I get to refresh my memory. I get to share quite an interesting fact with you and answer Brian's question, of course. That we can do. So Brian, now we've got a nice front-on view. VM is now focused on this Ellie's beautiful tusks. You can see that they're not that symmetrical. The tusk on the right-hand side is slightly more elegant than the tusk on the right. It's also slightly more curved. There you can see her using her tusks to devastating effect on that buffalo thorn. very dexterous trunk, no bones in that trunk, it's just one muscle containing every single muscle fiber that mammals can produce, including one that is unique to elephant, the helical muscle. And very, very dexterous with that trunk. Can pick up something as small as a pea, can bash down something as large as that tree you see in the background of her trunk there. Have a look at the two fingers at the end of the trunk, unique to the African elephants. The forest elephant and the plains elephant have the two fingers. Indian elephant only have one finger at the end of their trunk. Have a look at that. There's VM got it. Two fingers. And that is her nose. She has two nostrils at the end of her nose. And she will be breathing through her nose as well as using it to pluck vegetation and put it in her mouth. She'll also discipline her calf with the trunk, turning it into a club to smack babies with. And if I were to come waltzing up on her, she'd use it to discipline me as well. They can make the most unbelievable noises with those trunks. And there, right on, you can see that one very curved tusk and the other one that is fairly straight. Still very, very upward swept for a female elephant. Generally, their tusks follow the line of their trunk and away from their eyes towards the ground. This female has tusks, while not completely bizarre, definitely not usual. You can see how the two points are facing outwards, very similar to how male tusks are. Look at her using that tusk. Isn't that amazing? So yesterday, for those of you who were lucky enough to watch last night, was it last night where they had that notch? The day before. The day before, we filmed an elephant with a feeding notch in one of her tusks. And she had used it for so long, she was so old and she'd been using it for so long, and it actually produced a little nick. This elephant hasn't. She's using her thicker tusk to break off branches. Let's see what she does. She's going to use it again, methinks. Currently, she's just stripping the branches away from that buffalo thorn. Grabbing sticks. So we've had two answers on our infrasound question for Brian. Sacrosanct I've now completely missed the one. But sacrosanct, let me answer the sacrosanct's answer. Said that the lowest sound produced by elephant is 7 hertz, Brian, 7 hertz. And infrasound is developed at lower, any hertz lower than 20 hertz, and that's from Getz Gecko. So sacrosanct has mentioned or has researched the fact that elephants can go down to at least 7 hertz, which is amazing. And to give you an idea of when infrasound starts to be produced, it's at 20, and that comes from Getz Gecko. So I just have to say thank you very, very much for helping me with that. And Brian, I hope that is an amazing fact for you. You sound like someone that has dealings in that sort of thing. And perhaps, Brian, what you could do is reply with some comparison. Give us some idea of what that actually means. What 7 hertz can do. What is it similar to what humans can produce in machines, or what we can do with 7 hertz? Let us have some or other type of idea how low that is. To me, it's just a number, 7 hertz. But then again, I'm not that well versed in radio waves or sound. Sean has asked if rhinos are the closest living relatives to elephant. And I'm gathering, Sean, that you're looking at the grayish appearance of rhino, the fact that they are massive and have a big horn on the front of their nose, as some similarity to the gray skin or the gray tone of elephants, and the fact that they are also massive animals and have tusks rather than a horn, but still some sharp pointy things that stick out the front of their heads. The answer to that question is no, Sean, except that they do share some small similarities. Rhino are, in particular white rhino, are part of a group of animals called pterosodactyls, and the rhino are more closely related to zebras, funnily enough, odd toed ungulates. Zebra is the closest living relative to a rhinoceros, where elephant are closer related to a little animal called a rock hyrax. Or rock hyrax, or the dassie, is the elephant's closest relative. And for rhinoceros, the closest relative out here is a zebra. I know that sounds most bizarre, but it has to do with their jaw structures, their foot structure. It has to do with their genealogy. And it's fairly easy to research. Have a look at that very good camouflage of this female. Now moving, here you can see. Fanning her ears, that creates a draft across her body, and it also cools the blood in her ears down. It's not a very hot day today, but she is still fanning ears. It's got nothing to do with her being angry with us whatsoever. That's just literally just a big radiator. And that action there is not to do with us at all. It's to cool them down. Gwen in California has heard us refer to family groups and herds and was wondering if there was any difference between the two. Gwen, there's absolutely no difference between a family group and a herd. They are one in the same thing, and elephants form both. It's just one way of saying a herd. The slight difference comes in is that a herd can be made up of many family groups all living in association with one another. And the best example that I can think of right now are buffalo. Buffalo herds are made up of very many family groups all forming a mass, whereas elephants are made up of only usually one family group. Now, it's not uncommon to have many herds of elephants join together and form a massive herd, but it's not a thing that sticks together. They'll form massive herds together, usually all of them related in some way. They can number up to 1,000, I've heard. In the Sabi Sands, the largest herd of elephant that I've ever seen has been about 100 individuals. And I saw that as recently as earlier this year in the Manuleti, where I saw up to 100 elephant altogether. Usually related, they will be going to utilize a resource, either food or water, and then they split apart. Buffalo will never split apart. A buffalo herd made up of many different family groups stays together and moves through the bush together, and will only very infrequently and under very specific conditions or special conditions, abnormal conditions, all those family herds break up from one another. But generally speaking, a herd and a family unit is the same thing, but a herd can be made up of many family units, whereas a family unit is not made up of many herds. Now, these ellies have gone into some really tight bush. You've just got the bulk of this one female here next to us. I have lost the ability to start the car, which is not too much of a story. I'm sure at some point we will lose sight of these ellies, and then we will be sending you through to Jamie in a little bit, which will allow us to reposition the car and hopefully show you some more of this wonderful elephant herd that we have. And Jamie is ready to show you what she has to show you, and myself and VM are going to try and reposition the car so we can show you some more of these elephants.
In terms of updates from my side, I'm pretty much where you left me, funnily enough. I've done a big circle, found the leopard tracks again. He's still moving south, but it's really, really tricky tracking, because the ground is still slightly damp and compacted from the rain that we had. But he's coming this way, so essentially he moved into the Mawati drainage line and popped out on Vulture's Nest Road. And there we are, we've come further south. I think I've missed him crossing Nyala Road south. I've checked there as well, but because the ground is so hard and so damp in places around Nyala Road south, it's part of a natural seep line. I honestly don't know. You could easily have walked across that soil, and it's like tracking, as Steph would say, tracking tissue paper blowing across the ground in places. I'm guessing at the fact that it might be Mbula. It's a guess, just purely because we went more east than west. I mean, there's really not much to that. That is supposition, and at this point it becomes guess as to where he went as well. So I'm taking his general direction and trying to follow along from there. If it is Mbula, I know that he likes to walk along Mamba Road and out onto the Cheetah Cutline boundary. Just from that's happened a couple of times. It's not really any majorly accurate way of predicting. I wonder if they're not shouting. Unlikely, they're flying away. It was Hardy Dars. They've moved behind us. It'll be impossible for Brian to Thanks, Brian. There's a big tall animal there. I, of course, am just pretending I saw it. No, I really didn't. I had no idea it was there. Thanks, Brian. That's embarrassing. Too distracted by leopards and alarm calls. Hello, girl. Quite a tiny female, which is why I missed her, obviously. She's so small. Nice spots that she's got. They're not really defined spots. They're sort of more shapes. I wonder if she's going to be kind enough to let us get a slightly clearer view of her. Because at the moment, she's right behind the silver cluster leaf. I would like to say, in my defense, it's quite easy to miss a giraffe. It's really not. There's no defense for that. I just got distracted by leopards, or the idea of leopards. Hello, big girl. Obliging. You can see how important those eyelashes are as she ducks her head in there. A way of feeling for and protecting her eyes against thorns and sticks. Quiet, Hardy Dog. You're the reason I missed the giraffe in the first place. I'm sure we had a question through a couple of days ago about the length of giraffe tongues and whether or not it's true that they can touch the inside of their ear or clean their ears with them. They don't really clean their ears with them, but they could do it if they wanted to. And if we're lucky with this female, she might show us exactly how long that tongue is. I'm still looking for the right word to describe a giraffe tongue. And the level of coordination that it has. Have a look at the way that she is feeding. Mostly with her head down. Obviously that's because the tree that she's feeding on has been pushed over by elephants. But it's actually fairly common, especially with female giraffe, to see them feeding at the lower levels. And it's one of the big arguments for the idea that the neck of a giraffe didn't evolve in order to help them feed higher up. And that in fact, similar to the dinosaurs that were discovered with the long, long necks, so things like Diplodocus and Brachiosaurus, the idea that it actually evolved as in a similar way to the reason horns evolved, so a reproductive tactic. Got a passenger who wants to bite me. Here we go. Sorry, buddy. He was just crawling up my leg. Gonna let him go on there. Those mandibles. Don't bite me. Oh, dear, no. Don't go that way. Put him on my hat so he doesn't stress out as much. You go, dude. Come. Come. I'd prefer not to get bitten by those jaws. One of the ground beetles, and those mandibles can be very, very fierce. I prefer not to demonstrate that with my own finger. It's a way of actually wood boring. I've been bitten by them before. It's distinctly unpleasant. I'm going to return him without terrifying my giraffe. Come on, boy. Right, girl. Hi. You gorgeous. You finished with that tree. You're also pregnant. I seem to be on a roll. I'm not intentionally looking for pregnant animals, I swear. I guess it's just that time of year. She's huge. That big girl. Stop and munch there. And yes, chatting a little bit about the incredibly versatile and flexible tongue of the giraffe. I'm going to move backwards. I think she'll let me. She's quite nice and relaxed. Truly, in a way, it is very similar in construction to the trunk of an elephant. I'm going to stop there just because I don't want her to go running away. Maybe she might give us a demonstration of her tongue. That is sort of what I'm getting at, is the way in which it can bend in different directions and has a level of flexibility. I'll roll back a few more so we can get the pattern out. Well, you're going to be cooperative. Behind the quarry bush. But yes, that is sort of what I mean, the way that it can twist and wrap around the various branches and leaves. It's dexterous. She's gonna move off backwards. I think I'm gonna let her move off. She's going into some relatively thick bush back there. I don't think we're gonna get another clear view. Yes, the way that it can twist and curl independently and wrap itself around leaves. It's driving me mad. There's a word. It's not flexible, it's dexterous. Dexterous is what I was looking for. There we go. The level of dexterity that those tongues have, it's not quite to the same extent that elephants do. Obviously, elephants have the most amazing amount of control over their trunks. And that multi-purpose usage, anything from cracking branches and pushing down trees right to the point of wrapping around and picking up the tiniest stick if they want to. Being able to curl around dirt. Those magical things. But giraffe and elephant have those similarities, and they're also, of course, the only two animals that can feed at the height that they do usually feed at. Interestingly enough, the elephant has the highest feeding height. It's higher than any male giraffe. Why it is that giraffes are such solitary animals. I could say because it's big and they don't need the protection of the herd, but of course elephants are big and they love, you know, they live in herd structures. And the thing about giraffes is that they're not always completely solitary. So they move between, they sometimes are with other giraffe for company, then they move off on their own, then they come back again. They've got no set herd structure. Quite often you'll see females, or you're more likely to see females together in a group, just because it provides an extra set of eyes and warning. But I don't have an answer for you as to why they evolved as solitary beings versus why they don't live in a herd structure. I honestly don't know. I'd be interested to see if any of you have any theories on it. It's a herd structure or a social structure that's really similar to kudu in its own way. Just completely without any kind of pattern or general rule. Really interesting. Unlike the giraffe, the elephant has a very set social structure, and I believe that Steph is still with his herd of elephants.
We've moved out of that thick bush where those illies were. They were just going into places that will not be good for Rusty. And although these cars can and do some of the most amazing things, it wasn't worth where they were going, and we wouldn't have been able to see them for much longer. So what we've done is we've now come into an area roughly perpendicular to the where the leopard tracks that Jamie had were heading, but quite far in front. And the reason why I did this is because you just never quite know when you're going to get lucky. You never quite know how far that leopard walked last night or in the morning. And so myself and VM have come onto an area where we find, quite often we find male leopard tracks. Now, although you can't predict where these animals are going to be at any given time, what you can do is predict the fact that they do behave like we do, and they fall into routines. And if he's in this area, there's a good chance that he'd be walking on this road. And the fact that it rained so hard the day before yesterday means that all his territorial markings have been washed away, and he's going to be needing to come down this road to re-establish his territory, and that's what we're hoping to catch at the moment. That is what Brent thrives on. Georgie in Massachusetts has asked, just while we're having a look at this absolutely gorgeous Franklin, how do we name the leopards? Georgie, it changes from area to area, to be honest with you, but here in the northern Sabi Sands, the privilege goes to the guide who sees the leopard first. So he's the first one to view the cub, and generally is a description of that cub's personality or the area that it was found in. It doesn't necessarily follow any particular format. Although that leopard's name will change as it moves into adulthood. Female leopards tend to stay in the same area or very close to where they were born. Male leopards become nomadic and move off. And they can move into an area who don't know that leopard, and at which point they will give it a new name. Also, once again, based on where that leopard is, or where it likes to, or where it was seen for the first time, or a particular character trait. Now, lovely call. Now, I don't know if you are aware, but the leopards of the Northern Swabi Sands are incredibly well documented, with histories on almost all of them. And I'm sure you'd be able to find some information on our website that'll be able to give you an idea of just exactly how amazing the information resource is on the leopards here in the Northern Swabi Sand. Isn't it such a bizarre call from such a beautiful little bird, that the Koki Franklin, C-O-Q-U-I, the Koki Franklin. And it's got such a bizarre scientific name. I'm actually just going to find out exactly. The genus is Ternistus. Ternistus means one who trips with a heel, and it is in reference to the spurs that you can see on the feet. You can see, I think you can see the spurs on the feet. Yes, you can see two tiny little spurs on the males. So Ternistus, and then Koki, which is, they say, probably an imitation of its call. So Ternistus, Koki is the genus and species. Koki is, that doesn't sound like he's saying Koki whatsoever. So I'm not quite sure what the person who named this bird was smoking at that time. But Ternistus is quite an interesting name. And the birds will fight one another with those spurs, kick at one another. But I've never seen a Koki Franklin with damage. But I do know that larger birds definitely can do some damage with their spurs, with those little spurs. Putting some decent effort into that call. Call and listen, call and listen. But don't you think that the colors on this little bird are just so fantastic? That honestly is just the most amazing thing. Ah. And is that what he's calling about? Is he has some ladies, or is that a different... That looks like a crested spurfowl. It doesn't look like... It doesn't look like a Koki Franklin. Where are you looking, Vim? I can't even see.
Right behind the paper.
Ah. So it's probably about 5 meters away. I'm just picking up my binoculars. And that is an absolutely different type of Franklin. That is the crested Franklin. Slightly larger than our tiny little Koki Franklin that is busy calling his head off over here. Also just as cryptically colored, although lacking those bold colorings that the Koki Franklin has. Yeah. We've got some wildebeest busy contact calling in front of us. I think let's go and have a look at them. I'm going to leave the little Koki Franklin to his termite mound. Ah, and we've got some zebra and wildebeest. Lots of general game here this morning in Frontier. And impala. So zebra and wildebeest and impala all standing together. What's your head, Yavim? see if it gets a little bit more open here in front. I'm trying too much here to try and get everything into the same view for you, but we will try. We have wildebeest in the background. There are two wildebeest. And we have zebra off on this side. There's a zebra there for you. You do find wildebeest and zebra often with each other, and they use one another to uncover food that they each like. Zebra will eat the top of grass quite readily, and wildebeest like to eat the bottom of the grass. Sorry, it's the other way around. Wildebeest will eat the top of the grass, and zebra will quite readily eat the bottom of the grass. And wildebeest are also a little bit more alert, as are zebra in actual fact. They'll use one another to try and help look for predators. It's a type of symbiosis where both parties benefit, and that type of symbiosis is called commensalism. We'll look at that youngster having a quick feed. Wow, bashing mom over there. Gee whiz. Oh, cute. I don't think there's anyone that is untouched by how lovely a scene it is watching a baby be nursed from their mom. Isn't that lovely? Now, I did know Jamie said that last night she had counted all of the wildebeest in our wildebeest herd, and there were still 10 babies, some of them even getting some of their horns already. So they're growing up very quick. It's nice to know that they're not all being hammered. Question on whether or not the baby would hurt mom by bashing into her udders like that. I do see, and especially if they start getting their horns coming out, I do see moms definitely look like they take a bit of strain with their babies bashing into their udders like that. I've seen it with kudu as well. But it doesn't look like it does any damage, to be honest. I think they do it more with their mouths and with their front of their nose. And every species of mammal that I've ever seen nurse does that. They bump the udder for milk to come out, or for the mother to start producing milk. It seems to stimulate milk production. And now that these little wildebeest calves are starting to get a little bit older, the obvious question of how long do they nurse for comes into being. They'll nurse for around about 8 months. Generally speaking, until their mothers are well underway with their next calves and stop to produce milk. But if the mother loses her calf for whatever reason, they can nurse up to 16 months, obviously until the next cycle when she produces or ovulates again so that she can fall pregnant again, with most of the calves being born in a synchronized manner or within a few days of one another. And that helps for increasing or decreasing the mortality rate to predation. They sort of bombshell the predators, keep them satiated, and give these little guys just that extra helping hand. And it's worked incredibly well for this particular herd. They've lost no calves to lions or to leopard since their babies were born, which is quite rare. Wildebeest fall exactly in The lion's prey range of between 50 and 300 kilogram, or between 100 pounds and 600 pounds, is what lion are naturally built to eat. Look at that. It's really awesome. You can see that these young calves are obviously tasting grass. And why they are so healthy is because they're getting milk and they're eating grass. The best of both worlds. Making most of the green flush from the rain that we had now, probably close to 48 hours, just less than 48 hours ago, and which has created a flush of grass that has come over from the roots of the grass. The grass just would have stuck its fresh leaves out of the ground. As much as 48 hours ago, the grass had been burnt here to an absolute cinder by the sun and the drought that is in full swing at the moment. But we've been overcast here for about 48 hours with a lovely rainstorm two afternoons ago, and the grass has responded to that. And these calves are making the most of the flush. As you can see, almost a frantic eating going on. Very different skin color to the adults. Right now they're this lovely tan color, dark stripe on their face. When they're adults, they'll turn into a lovely dark gray, black color with stripes on their sides. And are blue wildebeest. Blue or brindled wildebeest is the name that they are. We don't find black wildebeest as a comparison to what else is possible here. We don't find black wildebeest here, just the blue wildebeests. We've got a bit of a battle going on here between with a crested barbet and a lilac-breasted roller pair. Remy in San Diego has asked, how do baby wildebeest know what to eat? And Remy, while we're having a look at this crested barbet, this pair, having a fight with the lilac-breasted rollers for a nesting space, I think. Remy, the baby wildebeest are born precocial, meaning they are covered in hair, their eyes are open, they have full function of all their senses, and literally within a couple of minutes can run. Precocial babies copy their parents almost move for move. And that is exactly what's happened here, is this precocial calf is copying what mom and dad are doing and will do that for many, many months, to learn exactly how to behave, what to do in certain circumstances. As opposed to an altricial baby, which is how our babies are born, blind and helpless and naked. Altricial babies generally have to tough it out and have to be taught, whereas precocial babies copy. Maybe using humans as an example was quite bad there. Let me use lions as an example. It's a much better example. Lions being or giving birth to altricial young mean that the female lion who hunts and is quite dangerous, in danger of getting her tummy kicked by any number of animals, and can't be slowed down or encumbered by a big heavy pregnancy, shed their babies relatively quickly. And that doesn't allow the babies to develop as much. It also means that she can have more babies at any one time. And when mortality rates are very, very high, having more babies is sometimes more beneficial than having one fully formed baby. And lions will then give birth to blind, helpless cubs, which take a long time to develop outside of the womb and need to be taught almost everything. Lion cubs watch their parents and are taught. Precocial babies or babies generally are not born in groups or in litters. It's not uncommon to have cubs, to have twins, but generally singularly, and are born fully functional, are born with their senses functioning and able to move around very quickly, and very quickly learn the habit of copying their parents, as opposed to lions, which only really become beneficial members of the pride anywhere from about a year to a year and a half. Obviously, wildebeest will very quickly, within 6 to 8 months, will become very beneficial members of the herd. So there's contrasting the two, perhaps not the two best answers. Maybe I should have used birds as a better example. But nevertheless, that is what happens. Now, these wildebeest and the zebra seem to have split off from one another. The wildebeest have gone to below the seep line, whereas the zebra have gone to above the seep line. Ooh, and we've lost the ability to start the car again, which is not too much of a problem. As we can still see a zebra's bottom. Now, yesterday we had a question that I wasn't able to answer as to how do you sex zebra from a distance. One of the ways that you can do it is definitely by looking underneath the tail. And at a distance, their external genitals are not readily visible. So the way you do it is by having a look at how wide the stripe is, the vertical stripe underneath the tail. If it's a pinstripe, it's a male, and if it's a wide stripe, comparatively speaking, it's a female. And as soon as I can move the car, I will reverse a little bit up the road and I'll show you what we're talking about. For now, we've got that wonderful blaze on the forehead of that zebra. My favorite part of an entire zebra's coat lies on their forehead. I just love that chevron pattern that they have. Now, what's quite interesting about where we are is that we're on a seep line. And seep lines are in this area where you have water from the surface, water from the crests being pushed out at a line. It's sort of our spring, for lack of a better word, where a spring is a point where water is pushed out. This is generally in a patch. And we're right on that spring at the moment. The spring is demarcated by a specific tree. And that tree is, we'll just wait for VM to, this tree here. This is a silver cluster leaf. And where you find silver cluster leaves, you find seep lines. And what's quite interesting is the zebra have gone above the seep line and the wildebeest have gone below the seep line. And different grasses will grow at both places. Below the seep line, you tend to have better quality grasses. Above the seep line, you tend to have poorer quality grasses. And because fundamentally wildebeest and zebra have different digestive systems, zebra have hindgut fermentation as a digestion, whereas wildebeest are ruminants. Ruminating animals have to eat a much higher protein diet. They have to go for the better quality grasses. But those grasses are also much more competed for. Whereas the zebra, with their hindgut fermentation and their ability to eat a very wide range of grasses and very coarse grasses, are able to go onto the crests and utilize grass that isn't under that much pressure, under that much feeding pressure from other animals. And that's why we've seen the zebra and the wildebeest splitting from where they are. This dry season means that there's ultra competition for the good grasses, and where they can, animals will try and go to their niches right now, and is why we see two splitting. If there were grasses everywhere, and good grasses everywhere, we'll see these animals moving in unison with one another. They wouldn't have to compete for food, and so they can use their herd to look for predators. Jamie is ready to for you, so that she can update you on what she's been up to, which will give us the chance for us to reposition this vehicle and show you how to sex zebra from a distance. See you now.
I've slowly worked my way south down to Gowrie Vein to try and work out where this leopard has gone to. I've lost the tracks completely. Last tracks I had were heading in this general direction. Soil and the light also doesn't help. The sun's not really out to catch the tracks and make any kind of shadow or reflection. Sorry, it's a good place to look. I just want to double check. I imagined a leopard in a tree. Tricky for tracking at the moment, not making our lives any easier. So I'm just trying to guess at where that leopard might pop out. There's certain patches of wet soil that make it almost impossible. Do you get something there, Brian, or is it just hyena? Lots and lots of hyena activity. One very cheerful woodlands kingfisher chirping away. Awesome to hear. So we got asked a question about females and male zebras yesterday by Barbara, and Steph has a really good way of showing you, so let's pop over to him.
And Barbara, the zebra, of course, if you're still watching from yesterday, the zebra have of course now decided to move off, but watch there, there we go. Just as the zebra wags her tail, you'll notice that the vertical stripe is relatively broad. The one on the far right-hand side has a thinner pinstripe. Have a look when the tail lifts up, you'll see that it's a thinner pinstripe. Although I think that one is a female as well. Yes, that's a female as well. But the nice thing is that we can sex them using the vertical stripe underneath the tail as an indication. That is a wide stripe. We'll see if there's some on the left as well of them that are walking away from us. Although the branches are making it very difficult. There we go. Please wag your tail. There we go. Nice big wide stripe. A couple of fingers across. That is a female. If it was literally thinner than a finger, it would be a male. Looks like all of these are females that we're watching. There will be a herd stallion here somewhere. And Barbara, if you are still watching, I know it's taken us probably a good 24 hours to answer your question, but I'm glad that we got to do it in any case. So sexing a zebra using the vertical stripe underneath the tail. Just to recap on that, a nice wide one like you're looking at now, a couple of fingers across, is a female. If it was nice and skinny, less than a finger in width, then it would be a male. Other than that, they're actually quite difficult to sex unless you're looking at them in comparison next to one another. But I think let's carry on going. I know VM is smiling. He's got leopard racing across his forehead. If VM's forehead could light up like a billboard, he would be using some choice language to tell me to carry on driving and find him a leopard. Be flashing lights, leopard. I can show it to you as well. All right, let's carry on. We are going to be, obviously, looking at prey items is a very good way of finding predators. There's a lot more food out here than there is predators. You can see now we're coming into the open. This area here is the bottom of the seep line. And I'll show you now when we get to where the collection point is. These wildebeest are below the seep line, eating the high protein grasses. Fortunately, there are fewer of them. The zebra have just decided, why even bother, and they're going to the top of the hill to eat the more coarser vegetation. Now this is a beautiful example of a seep line. It's a very healthy seep line. There is the seep where the trees stop. And the reason why the trees have stopped is because this is waterlogged. All this area here is waterlogged in wet seasons. And trees find it very difficult to germinate when it's wet. The water then runs and coalesces where we are right now, and then runs off into the drainage line. And this is where the drainage line starts. It's the birthplace of a river right here. We're in the nursery. We've just moved from the nursery to, I suppose, grade one. And that's where the drainage line that eventually goes through Philemon's Dip and into the Mulwati starts. And the Mulwati runs then into the Nwati Tsonso, which is probably about 50 yards wide and 3 yards high and deep, and will run into the, let me think now which river it runs into. It runs eventually into the Sabi River, and that is a really big river, and then eventually into the Indian Ocean as a decent river. Here over my head we've got quite rare a lilac-breasted roller. VM will probably be able to zoom in so close to it you'll be able to see its eyeball reflection. There we go. You could probably screenshot that and see the reflection of our vehicle in his eye. Yes, absolutely, I can almost see our vehicle in his eyeball. Maybe I could wave and you could even see that we're so close to this lilac-breasted roller. Isn't that wonderful? The reason why he's here . There we go, another screenshot, boom. And the reason why they're here is because there's another lilac-breasted roller on the stick just adjacent to this one that has caught something and is busy killing it and eating it. You can notice that their colors are not as brilliant as they were just a few weeks ago, and that is because the lilac-breasted rollers have finished breeding, competing for mates and bringing up their babies. They're actually in very bad condition now because they've had to bring up their youngsters and have been expending a lot of energy on their babies. This one will probably fly off relatively soon. Looks like a youngster. It's actually just getting into its plumage, its adult plumage. You can see that brownish tinge. Nevertheless though, that brilliant aquamarine blue. What are you doing there? Trying to get in something out, clean its beak. On the feathers, and then that lilac breast, which is diagnostic for this roller, just coming out. Cleaning the beak. They're insectivores, although they will eat almost anything. They're carnivorous birds. They eat insects, lizards, mice, snakes, termites, dragonflies, you name it, they'll catch it and try and kill it. Quite a big bird, relatively robust. And they live here year round. Unlike their cousins, the European rollers, who fly all the way to North Africa and the Mediterranean Rim during our summer, lilac-breasted rollers are a constant beauty. Whoa. Look at, once again, we're so close that you'll be able to get the reflection of our vehicle in this eye. Oh. And the reason why it flew off like that is because a grey go-away bird gave an alarm call for a little predator, that a little hawk or falcon that was flying over here, and this bird had to get off the ground in case they were caught unawares. And that was just a way in which other birds giving an alarm call cause a reaction on these birds. Wasn't that wonderful though? Nice to see. Right, let's carry on. For those of you with a keen interest in our weather, clouds look like we've got some low-level clouds scudding in over the horizon, coming in underneath the high-level clouds at the moment. I don't quite know what the rain prediction is, and even if it did predict rain or didn't predict rain, it is notoriously imprecise, as I'm sure you have close to you as well. Weather is very difficult to predict. In fact, some of the largest computers in the world can't even predict weather. There's just too many factors, too much information. All right, so now we're coming back out of the seaplane. And we're going to be turning onto Zoe's Road, another very good road for male leopards, or for the male leopard that is in question. I'm almost convinced it's Mvula, who comes in from the Gari main side. And basically his entire territory is Juma. Although of late we are seeing him confined to the more western areas as Tingana pushes up from, or sorry, Mvula is confined to the more eastern areas and northern areas, Tingana more to the south and to the west, as Tingana is being forced out of Arethusa by the Anderson male. Leopard territories are like amoebas, their boundaries are constantly moving. It all depends on their age and their condition and basically where they are. This bird is going to fly, I know, but we're going to try and get it anyway. It's a little emerald spotted dove there, and the emerald spot is on the wing below the eye, directly below the eye. You should be able to get an emerald spot, two of them. There we go. And now at this angle we can't see that emerald spot, but it's iridescent. There is coming out on the left hand side. You see the two, oh, there we go. Anyway, emerald spotted wood dove is what we had over there. Well done, VM, you got that. So we've got emerald spotted wood dove. They got the most beautiful Shangaan name. They call the Shivambalan. Shivambalan is the Shangaan name for the emerald spotted wood dove, and is probably in reference to their call. They got this beautiful, mournful call. All right, so back to our leopard search in this area. I'll be keeping a peeled eye on the road for any signs of this leopard track coming this way. So what I'll do is I'll scan ahead until I see a patch of sand that will hold the track nicely. Search the bush on either side, looking far, middle, near and underneath each tree as much as I can. And then when I get to that patch of sand, I then take the car slightly off of the track and have a look. And the best place to look for leopard tracks is on the inside curve of a road. Next time you're watching leopard with us, leopard will almost always take the shortcut on the inside curve of a road. They don't like walking on the outside curve on these roads. Yeah, inside curve on my side, on the driver's side. I go slightly off of the track. I look intently at the sand, hopefully trying to convey to you that I know exactly what I'm doing and what I'm looking at, in the hope that we see some leopard tracks. Give us a clue as to where this male leopard might be. It's good practice to switch off your car every now and again, which is why I did it for that dove. Normally, doves would fly off at the first provocation, but we did that was for two reasons. One is that the dove was sitting still and it's nice to show you. Two is that it gives us a chance to listen to the bush with the vehicle off. Quite often monkeys are the giveaways for leopard. Monkeys would tell us where leopard are by alarm calling at them, and they're very vociferous and their sound carries very far. And I would say easily more than half the time that we find leopard out here is due to monkeys calling. Can't hear monkeys calling over the soft purr of this engine. Definitely drowns out monkey calls from far away. So it's a good idea, it's a good practice to get into, to switch your car off when you're looking for leopard. At some point they will disturb the bush around them, whether it's a kudu, impala or monkeys or whatever, and give us a better clue as to where they are. It doesn't look like a male leopard of any sort or a leopard of any sort walked down this road. But there is a crossroads coming here. Jamie has just tracked that leopard, and I've been told that the tracks cross into Torchwood, which is exactly opposite to where we are right now. So much for my educated guess on where we think this leopard could be. I must be honest with you, I must stop getting disappointed with that. I must rather ask you to remind me if I predict where an animal's gonna be. I must go absolutely against my instincts and go in the opposite direction. Maybe we'd be lucky enough to pull one out of the bag that way. So knowing that those tracks crossed into Torchwood, we can almost say with a fair amount of certainty that a full-grown male leopard track that we find, full-grown, big, bulky male leopard track, is there's a good chance that it's Mvula. And although we didn't see him, we do know that he's doing well. He's busy patrolling his territory, doing what he does. And maybe what it can mean is the fact that Tingana, knowing that Mvula might be quite far away, will push into this area to re-establish his markings. Question come through from the secret judge. Is there a town close to this place? Yes, the closest town is 90 kilometers away, so about 70 miles away, so just over 70 miles away, and it's called Hoedspruit. H-O-E-D-S-P-R-U-I-T. Hoedspruit is the closest town to where we are right now, and is about 60-70 miles away. And on that note, we are going to be crossing over to Jamie, who's got something to tell you.
So after a morning spent crisscrossing the various roads in a sort of a grid pattern, guessing and getting very lucky, unfortunately it looks as though our male leopard has crossed east into Torchwood. He popped out just to the east of us on Cheetah, walked south and then went straight into Torchwood. Makes me think or suspect that it was probably a Mvula that we were tracking. That's again guesswork, but it's more likely to be him on this side of the property. He spends a lot more time around Torchwood. You're not gonna stay, are you? You're gonna stay? Being very cooperative. completely frozen. Hoping that we can't see them. He's just he's moving there. Hello, girl. Should I run? Should I not run? Not quite sure what to do there. You can see a little black strip down her face. Here she goes. There's always a little bit of indecision in the way that little antelope move when they run away from you. They run in sort of stops and starts. You can see she's relaxed a little bit. As soon as she gets into comfortable thick bush, then she stops and has a look backwards. Make sure that we're not following her. Alrighty, well, our leopard is on a walkabout onto Torchwood. Must have been Imbula, I'm fairly certain it was. It was interesting tracking him though and trying to predict the different pathways that he was going to take and where he was going to walk to. There was a lot of luck involved as well in figuring it out, but it was still fascinating to watch. And he actually walked very definitely in certain directions. Following a regular patrol route. I'm on my way now to Bufflesham Dam. I'm hoping that Karula might have decided to make an appearance, pop out of Bufflesham at some point. She's such a mystery, that one. She'll disappear for a couple of days and then pop out completely in the opposite direction of where you expected her to be. I remember once having a sighting with her sitting in a jackalberry tree close to the Bufflesham Dam, and the next morning she was all the way at the Gowrie Repeater. And I mean, it was a sort of space of about 8 hours that she walked easily 5 kilometers and probably more given the way that she bobs and weaves. The good news is that those tracks from Imbula were fairly fresh. The white-tailed mongoose tracks were on top of them. So it was from sometime, probably in the middle of last night, that he walked down that road. Probably just after Deb heard him at the Juma Dam camera. It was probably about an hour or two after that he wandered down that road. I'm fairly certain it was him sawing. Could also, of course, have been Karula. So both males and females will do that territorial sawing sound that is a leopard's roar. It's time to go and investigate Bufflesham Dam and see what's happening there. I haven't been there since the rains. I know Steph was there and he said that there were 2 puddles. I wish it would rain again. It definitely has that feel. It's actually genuinely nippy, isn't it, Brian? Very cold. And Wicked Blues Band, you were wondering how much rain we've had in the last 2 days. I suspect that one big rain that we had 2 days ago probably gave us about maybe 10 mils, I would guess, roughly. Obviously that differs from in different parts of the property, but I think probably about on average 10 mils. And it hasn't rained since then, if I'm completely honest. There were smatterings that afternoon after the big rain, and then after that was it. It was done from there. So it hasn't rained since then, unless I missed something during the night, but I don't think I did. It was just that one day that we had the rain. It's not really, I mean, it's enough certainly to come as a relief. It's definitely made life a little bit nicer for the animals out here. At least they've got some groundwater to drink from. We saw the kudus drinking from the puddles earlier. So it's definitely taken the pressure off a little bit, but it's not really good enough to alleviate the true effect that the drought's going to have in the next few months. Happening at Buffalo's Hook. Hey, there's that buffalo. I'll explain the metal netting in a moment. Oh no, don't walk away, buddy. He's such an instantly recognizable character. There he goes, Brian. He's the one with all the ox pickers up to the up a little bit and to the right. Yeah, that one. Look at him. He reminds me, oh, I need him to look properly at the screen so I can show you what I mean. His boss goes right down to the bottom of his eyes, or to the top of his eyes, sorry, and it's a really straight line. Oh, he's not being cooperative. Hello, boys. I'm fairly certain this is the same group of Dugger boys that was here yesterday with Steph. The puddles have all but dried up. Oof. And these buffalo are definitely accompanied by an increase in flies that are attempting to sit on us. I think that one of the buffalo just sneezed. That was a very odd sound I just heard. Hello, boy. A little bit earlier, I mean, this particular individual has magnificent horns. But a little bit earlier, we saw that buffalo with a broken horn. And Baseball 21, you were wondering if a horn is broken, if it will ever grow back. And the answer is no, it won't. That won't happen. It's bone and keratin, and although it might have a little bit of stunted further growth, possibly, once a horn is broken on an antelope species or a bovid like the buffalo, it will never grow back. It does some serious damage to the growth points. And just quickly, since I'm sure it's in your screen and you might want to understand exactly what's going on there, in terms of these metal packings, this is a work in progress. It is known as a gabion. And what they're doing essentially is, because around these dam sites, what happens is the animals congregate around here and they take away all of the plant material through grazing and through movement that would keep the topsoil in place, and you get huge erosion channels that start to develop as the topsoils around the dams wash away. And so what the guys have been doing is they've been creating this netting cover with the rocks inside it to pack up the erosion parts and protect the sides of the dam a little bit. And obviously it's not always going to look that way, it's a work in progress. So once they've managed to pack that in, then they'll cover it with sand, and it just helps to stop the effects of erosion out here. And since this is an artificially constructed dam, it therefore comes with the additional responsibility of protecting the area around it. Let's shift around to see what he's doing. I think he's trying to get water in that puddle. And while I do, Haomi, you were wondering what the lifespan of a buffalo is. And for the big males like this one, once they reach the sort of age of around 8 or 9, they start to leave the herd and wander off on their own. And they probably, their lifespan is up to about 13 to 15 years of age in the wild. They don't get much older than that. They start to age, their teeth start to wear down, and they start to lose condition. And also you'll find that most of the animals here are carriers of tuberculosis. Oh, his back leg sunk into the mud there. And it starts to, it doesn't affect them in a huge way, but it does start to cause them to, their condition to deteriorate as they get older. Hey boy, it's all right. Shame, all your water's gone already, huh? Not much left anymore. That's very sad to see. Didn't last very long. We really needed 2 weeks of a good solid drizzle to start filling up these dam sites. With the ever-present ox picker hanging off his right ear. And apparently getting a little bit too friendly with it. For Deanna Ray, who's provided us with a bit of more information about the grackle that we chatted about earlier. So a relative of the orioles, in that sort of family, and quite closely related to the starlings that we see, which is what we suspected originally. So thank you very much for that. I'm going to go and have a look at pictures of them when I get home, just so that I know for future reference. And I'm hoping, while we're talking about starlings, that this particular individual is going to be obliging and give us a nice view of it. They've got such a stunning glossy color, and it's coming out really nicely in this light. Come on, buddy. Aw. There you go. You can see, at least vaguely, that iridescent sheen. So when there's no sunlight or no light, they look completely black. Chirping there, and that iridescent effect is created not by any kind of pigments except melanin, which is black, but it's the way that the keratin along the feathers is layered to create a refraction of light that essentially bounces back only those blue and purple wavelengths of light. So that's the color that the starling takes on. This to me looks like a greater blue-eared starling. It's got a slightly darker tinge behind the eye. You can see him chirping there. Look at that beautiful gloss. Chirping away quite happily. Doing a little jog. Larynx works when he calls. That's so fascinating. I've never really looked at that before. Making poor Brian's life difficult, dashing as he is. So interesting to watch. He's about to move out of view. Beautiful bird to see. Our Dugger boys are still looping around the back of the dam. They haven't had much in the way to drink here. And just while we're still looking at these buffalo, to finish off with the question about horns being broken, Shrub, who's watching on YouTube, you were wondering how that might happen. And for the most part, it's caused when buffalo bulls fight and spar. And I mean, you can imagine the force involved when 900 kilograms, so close to 2,000 pounds worth of buffalo bull moves at 15 meters per second and then bashes heads. You can imagine how if that caught a horn at the wrong angle, it would cause such serious damage, and it could actually potentially break it off. I also quite often suspect, and I could be wrong about this, but I suspect that it occurs when there's a slight crack or fault in the bone or in the way that the bone is developed. I think that certain animals are more disposed to having broken horns than others. Just like they have genetically different shapes to their horns. Some have a slightly bigger curl, some have slightly stockier horns. and some extend further away from the ears, I suspect that they're also born with genetic fault lines and cracks within the bone of the horn itself. I wouldn't be surprised if that's the case, particularly if they've suffered some kind of injury as a calf when those horns are still solidifying and developing. I imagine that that also causes weaknesses in the horns themselves. I could be wrong, it's just a suspicion that I have. I just think certain individuals are more disposed towards breaking horns, and you quite often see bulls with two broken horns. It's really the only animal out here capable of, or the most likely scenario in which a horn would be broken off is between a fight between two males. It's plausible that it might happen if they ran full speed away from something and maybe hooked their horn on something like a tree. Plausible but unlikely. They're fairly good at navigating their way through the various obstacles out here. I really wanted to try and introduce you to the buffalo character that I was talking about, but he hasn't been very cooperative. He's always slightly more skittish than the rest of the bulls in the group whenever we see him. And he reminds me very strongly, I can't work out who it is, but there is some celebrity that he reminds me of with his flat boss. It's quite unique. I've never seen, there he is. I've never seen a buffalo like it. We've seen him before. I mean, he's quite handsome in his own way. He's perfectly symmetrical. I can't decide what he reminds me of, though. I'm open to suggestions. We're looking at a group of Dugga boys, so a group of older males, but forgive me for possibly not getting your name correct. Mahosh Trahosh, or something along those lines. You wanted to know why the females also have horns. And the answer to that is, it's a bit complex, but we'll look at the way that the animals live and the habitat that they live in. And although it's never been completely proved, there's a fairly strong correlation between the two. So, for example, a species like a kudu or an inyala, they live in thickly vegetated areas. So the horns are used for two things. One is for competing with other males for access to females, and the other is defense of the animal itself from predators. So for kudu and inyala, the males still need to have the horns because they need to compete with other males for access to females. Whereas the females don't, and in fact, for those females, oh, there's some more Dugga boys coming. For those females, those horns would actually be a disadvantage because they'd get caught in the vegetation and the foliage. But for animals like buffalo that live more out in the open, the females don't rely on hiding behind vegetation. Ooh. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how horns get broken. I have no idea what that was about. A little bit too much in his personal space. But that just goes to show you how fast buffalo can move when they really want to. That was along a very narrow dam wall, and that buffalo didn't even blink an eyelid. It covered that space so fast. That came as a bit of a surprise. You didn't expect that. Okay, just a skirmish between buffalo bulls. It does happen fairly regularly. We often see them butting horns. So the horns on the females they're much less well developed than the males. They don't have thick bony bases at the bottom of them, like these gentlemen do. There's my favorite buffalo. It's definitely my favorite Dugga boy. but they do have horns, and they're there for a reason, to protect the flow against any kind of attack by predators. But because they aren't used for fighting in the females, they're not as well developed as they are in the males. Shame. And the poor gentleman that got chased has just emerged off the other side, looking distinctly disgruntled. Fine, if you guys don't want me, I'm going to hide behind this tree. Shame. He obviously doesn't feel welcome to go and join them at the dam. Got a slightly defeated looking body posture. Up there comes the rest of them. There's the aggressor there, still wandering along the dam wall. Ladies and gentlemen, we spent our morning tracking leopard. You win some, you lose some. In this case, he just happened to pop over into a different property. But some really interesting discoveries that we've made at that hyena den. And interesting to see if that theory proves to be correct. I don't think we'll ever know exactly what went on. But I do think that very sadly, that female has lost her cub or cubs at some point over the last few days, and I think that's actually why Pretty and Corky moved their cubs across to the Mbubu Road den. So an interesting sort of conclusion, if you could call it that, to that entire story and to that saga. Well, big thank you to you all for joining us. It's been a wonderful morning and I've enjoyed having you. Thank you to Brian as well for his amazing camera work as always, as well as his company, and to the lovely ladies in FC. I'm going to send you back across to Steph for the last few moments of our sunrise safari, but have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world, and don't forget to join us in a couple of hours for the sunset safari. Cheers for now.
Well, I hope wherever you are in the world that you are putting your hands together today so that we can get some rain here. That is what we need more than anything else today. And it's been a fantastic morning. VM and I have had an elephant morning, and then we spent some decent time with some zebra and wildebeest. It's been quite nice. For the rest, we've just been looking for leopard or lion tracks. One last question before we say goodbye from Sarah in Ohio, who wanted to know, has Mvula been seen anywhere close to Anderson? Not to my knowledge, Sarah, to be quite honest, but that is not saying much at all. I don't keep much contact with the reserves around us, even though I should. Brent would be able to answer that question a lot easier than I would. But not to my knowledge, I think they're too far away. But for myself and VM, we just want to say thank you very much for your input today. And we've had a lot of fun, and I hope that you have. And we'll see you on this afternoon safari.